works with that works with Falls Church. A little bit about myself. I taught in the classroom, self-contained setting with special ed for 4 years. And then I have since been working in school systems as an assistive technology specialist. Love working with students, love working with this population, and love working with Falls Church. Okay. And just heads up, I do plan on making this presentation a bit interactive. So I might ask a couple of questions, and if that's the case and you have some ideas or thoughts, just mention that you have a thought in the chat or raise your hand with the little emoji and we will call on you and get everyone involved, okay? All right, so today our objectives are just to really define assistive technology to gain an understanding of the AT decision-making process, to differentiate the different levels of AT, to understand how it can be used in the classroom, and then to also discuss how powerful it can be used at home as well, and fun, powerful and fun. All right, so just out of curiosity, how many of you all are familiar with the term or with assistive technology? Again, you can raise a hand, you can just come off mute. I see Melissa has a thumbs up. Awesome. Okay. All right. I see Elizabeth also has a thumbs up. Beautiful. Okay. All right. Very cool. Does anyone want to share your experiences or your thoughts or anything that you know about assistive technology? Does anyone feel comfortable?
This is Melissa. Excuse me, that I know of the term. I don't know all that much about it. We're sort of just getting started and introduced to it. So I love your objectives. They are spot on for what, I'm hoping to get from this today.
Awesome. Very cool. Okay. All right, let's move on. Awesome. Okay, so the truth is we've all interacted with assistive technology at some point in our lives, whether it's using our phones, just to text with the word prediction feature, using laptops, using spell check, using the grammar checks. Those are all different forms of assistive technology. We may not think about that when we think of it in a school model, but all of that is considered assistive technology. But we do want to focus on how it can be used with our students today. All right, so the formal definition of assistive technology, I always like going over the formal definition, is any piece of equipment or product or system, whether acquired commercially or off the shelf, modified or customized, that is used to increase, maintain, or improve functional capabilities of a child or adult with a disability. We really use assistive technology to support a student in working on a deficit or something that they may struggle with on their own, and using AT to bridge that gap, whether it be by communication, whether it be a mobility tool, whether it be just computer access. Maybe that student doesn't have the fine or gross motor ability to maintain access of a computer, so they might need the support of a tool or a specific type of keyboard. There's a variety of different things that we can use to support and improve the functional capabilities. So typically we have students in the school setting, we consider assistive technology to see how we can support them with their academic instruction. That could be through communication, that could be through giving them access to a word processing device that might help with their written output. It could be as simple as a piece of equipment that might help with PE, adaptive PE, anything that might support them in the school setting. And those things are considered in the IEP. Every year, the students have annual IEP meetings, and assistive technology is something that is considered. And at that point, the team will discuss whether or not the child is struggling to do something academically or complete a task. And at that point, we'll discuss any potential assistive technology that might support that student, just be the best they can be and access all things in the school environment. Okay. So now we're going to talk about the who, what, when, where, and how of assistive technology, okay? So who can use assistive technology? So typically a student who's not making progress towards their academic goals or objectives, or is having challenges. For example, if you have a fifth grade student and they're struggling with learning to read or doing a single digit addition or subtraction fact, that could be something that we may then look at AT to see how we could support that student. Or a student who requires access, physical access due to an orthopedic impairment, or just general access to the curriculum. A student who has restricted use of his or her arms and may need support turning a page on a book. Any of that, we would look at AT to support. Where can students use AT? So we at school use it in any environment that they're a part of, whether that be PE, the classroom, the cafeteria, any space in the school building that may occupy that child's time. We want to make sure they have access to all things that they need to be successful. If it's the cafeteria and the child needs adapted equipment to be able to eat lunch independently, or some type of specific chair that might allow them to be a part of the cafeteria table, whatever the student needs in order to participate in their customary environment. We also consider home a customary environment because oftentimes students do have homework and they do, when they do come home from school, we want to make sure they also have the appropriate tools and access to be able to be successful in continuing their learning from the school day. When do teams consider assistive technology? And this is a bit of a complex question, but typically when barriers exist that impact the student's access to the curriculum. So if we have a student who is excelling in all areas of the curriculum and their physical needs are being met and their environmental needs are being met, we typically wouldn't look at AT, but if there's anything that we can do to improve their performance in the classroom, we then typically see if there's anything we can do to bridge any type of gap or barrier for a student who may need that extra support. So that's when we would come to the table and consider AT for a student. And as I mentioned, every year it's considered as a part of a child's annual. All right. And why do we use AT? To level the playing field. So oftentimes we have children who have communication challenges, physical challenges, academic learning disabilities, and we use AT to try to get them to the point where they are able to be in an environment where they can learn with their peers and not have those deficits or challenges. Impair their ability to be a part of the classroom. Okay. And so, how do we decide that a student needs AT? So, this is generally a collaborative team decision. I love to get the AT myself, the AT specialist, the other assistive technology specialist who focuses on communication, speech pathologist, OTs, PTs, special education classroom teachers, it could be art teachers. I like to get everyone involved just so that we can look at the student from all areas and make sure that we're providing the best amount of information that really speaks to who the student is, where they're successful, what types of things you're trying to get that student to do in the school building, and where we could support them using technology. All right, and what might be considered assistive technology specifically? So I mentioned a couple of things, but there are specific writing tools. There's time management devices. There's built-in accessibility features. There are communication devices. There's note-taking tools. There are reading tools. A hearing aid could be considered an assistive technology support. We've got research tools, magnifying glasses, all kinds of things. Okay, and we break our assistive technology into different categories. So we have no tech, low tech or mid tech, and then high tech. So something like a communication device that is on an iPad or on a high tech computer system that displays a software that allows a student to access alternative communication would be high tech versus a pencil grip or an enlarged graph paper or a binder that might be raised for a student to elevate their computer, that would be no tech or light tech. Okay. And it really doesn't matter whether it's low tech, mid tech, or high tech. We really just try to give the students anything that could support them to be successful in the classroom. All right. So here's a couple more examples of technology that we might use in the classroom. Okay. All right. Thinking outside the box. So I mentioned some tools that we could use in the classroom. I mentioned there's graph paper, that there's pencil grips, there are communication devices. Something that is really new and now in assistive technology is VR, which is virtual reality. And I really love VR because it allows students to experience things that they may not be ready to experience in the outside world, or really a learning tactic. So, and I see a question in the chat. I'll take a pause after this one and get into answering questions. But VR is, as I mentioned, virtual reality, and it uses artificial intelligence and computer systems to pretty much give a student like a mini TV in a goggle frame. And within that mini TV, they can see and experience different things and physically interact with it. For example, I've worked with students who are learning how to use street signs appropriately in the community, but due to behavioral concerns, they may not be ready to go out in the community yet, but it is still an IEP goal as the student is working on academic life skills. So something like a VR set could support them with really experiencing walking around and getting to interact with the street signs, but not having to specifically go out in the environment quite yet. There are students who work on hand-eye coordination and working on just depth perception with VR, because it gives them different abilities to play different games that involve depth and involve hand-eye coordination and all kinds of things. It's really cool. And we actually have VR sets now in Falls Church, so that's something that we would like to get our students involved with. I see there's a question in the chat. Right now realizing, yep, awesome. I see someone saying, I'm now realizing that we've been using AT for years, just not calling it AT. Absolutely. So many different things are considered AT: low tech, high tech, mid tech. Just a computer in itself is AT. And typically our students will use AT in the classrooms to participate in just writing activities and reading activities and just using speech to text and text to speech. And I'm gonna get into some of that and how we can incorporate it into the home environment and make it fun for our students. So if we go to the next slide. Okay, we're gonna discuss how it can be used at home. Awesome. So one tool that we use that our students have access to in Falls Church is called Read and Write. I love Read and Write because it's a very user-friendly tool for our students. We have many students using it with success regularly. And it essentially is a toolbar of different supports for students. It lets you use text-to-speech on the internet. So if a student is working on reading a book online, it provides them with the ability to use text-to-speech to listen to that book. It also allows them it to pause and maybe define a word that they don't need with a picture dictionary, or excuse me, a word that they don't know with a picture dictionary. For example, if I'm reading about US history and I stumble upon a word I don't know, I can highlight it and then it'll provide a picture and then a definition. It also lets me use a screen masking window. So if I've got, you know, a page of 50 lines of words, it will allow me to pretty much highlight specifically one line at a time to kind of block out the extra words, just to help me with my pacing. And just a thought of a way this could be used for fun at home, giving the child an opportunity to use and explore the toolbar to assist with a creative writing activity. So using the word prediction feature or using speech to text, which are both tools in that toolbar, we can get our students to maybe write a creative story or write about their dream vacation or write about what they want to do over the weekend and just really play around with the toolbar and use some speech to text. And then when they're done, okay, let's reread what you wrote and let's use the text to speech feature now to listen to everything that you typed out. And then we're going to see if we can correct any errors and just hear how our work sounds and make sure our work looks as the way we want it to. So here is just a list of the different things in the toolbar. And I think you can have kids use it to make interactive journals, You can use it to have kids do read different fun articles. So that could be a cool way to use read and write at home. Next slide, please. Awesome. So this tool is called Poplet. And just FYI, all of these tools are free and readily available. So at the end of this presentation, I've attached links with resources on how to download or just how to find these different tools. So Poplet is a awesome tool that is essentially an online graphic organizer. And it's very picture-based, but it also allows you to include words. So if a student is working on learning their ABCs and their alphabet, they can, pick a letter, say they're working on the letter C. Well, let's think of all the different things around the house that we could write about that start with C. Oh, I see you found a cup. There's a car, there's corn, there's a cloth, and then they can use this organizing tool to add images and add different graphics to go along with the letter that they're learning. So that's a way that it can be used at home. It's very much an easy tool that can be downloaded in any app store, whether it's whether you're an Android or an Apple user, you can just download that app and then it's free to use. If you have a student who's learning about earth space science, you can, use this tool to have them explore and expand their different ideas on Earth and then have them describe it and use this tool to really add their thoughts. And then this is a super support for the writing process. So once you have your information on a graphic design and organizer, you can then use it to create a longer written task or assignment. All right. So something that we also use in Falls Church is called Cami. And Cami is an online annotation system. And it essentially allows you to take a PDF and edit it. So something that a student could use this for is to create and complete online scavenger hunts, word searches, fillable wish lists, or anything that they are excited about at home. So if you, as a parent, want to get, download a worksheet that's fun for them to do, or some type of game that involves, editing or modifying a document, they can then use Cami to circle things and to highlight things and to write on a document. So that's a fun way that we can use Cami at home. So that our next tool is called SnapType. This is an app that you would use on an iPad, and it allows you to take a picture of a worksheet, and then once you've collected that picture, you can then type directly on the screen to complete that worksheet. So while at home, a student can use an iPad or a phone to take a picture of a fun paper-based activity, a word search, crossword puzzle, and then complete that on the iPad. So a tool that we use to support students who are reading is called ReWordify. And ReWordify uses artificial intelligence, which is a buzzword these days, but it uses artificial intelligence to reduce the language intensity of a story or a piece of literature. So if I'm given a student a text at an eighth grade level, I can type a paragraph or a couple paragraphs. I can copy and paste it into ReWordify, and it will reduce it to a first grade level. And this just helps our students who, maybe accessing grade level curriculum, who may need that extra support so that they can work on their comprehension skills. It allows them to just still interact with that grade level material, but at a rate that they can understand it, maybe at their academic instructional level. So this is something that you can explore at home. Maybe if you guys are talking about current events in the house, and you are working with your child to find an article or find some type of story about a current event. You can copy and paste the literature and the text from that current event and then paste it into our search ReWordify engine, and then it'll reduce the text complexity so that the child can then understand it a little better. Okay. All right, speech to text. So this is something that many of us use on our phones when we're on the go. Speech to text allows you to speak into the computer or into the phone, and then it'll generate your words based off of your dictation. So it's essentially voice typing. So while at home, students can dictate creative writing stories or practice writing about things they're looking forward to, fun memories, maybe just a recap of what they did over the weekend or something they're looking forward to. If you open up a Google document, you can then go into tools, select voice typing, and then at that point, you just go ahead and start speaking, and it'll provide a dictation of whatever you're saying. And I think that if you have children who are working on writing at home, maybe diary entries or just creative writing or writing for fun and letting students know that they can write for fun, I think that this is a cool tool that can assist with that. Audiobooks. So we have a couple of different systems that we use for audiobooks. Learning Ally is one that is free. And children can just really get into reading for fun and reading for pleasure. Oftentimes, our students find reading to be a daunting task, especially when they have to turn the pages and work on just fluency and all of that. So audiobooks and ebooks really just allow them to remove having to decode and work on fluency and just listen to the stories. And oftentimes these online ebook systems have images to go along with the books, which also help with the comprehension. So while at home, if you have a student pick out a type of book that they would like, you can just go into the Learning Ally library, find that book, and then it'll provide an audiobook. Audiobooks in the library. So you can still have your child go and explore and have fun in the library. And when they pick out a book, oftentimes the physical books are also available in audiobook form. Okay. KiwiWrite is a fun tool as well. So this is a math tool. And if you have a child who has issues with legibility or issues with just kind of organizing their math in a row or just making it look neat on paper, KiwiWrite allows you to just do the math work digitally. Also, if again your child has fine or gross motor challenges where just writing is a barrier, this can really alleviate that. And in order to use KiwiWrite, you would just select the numbers that you want to use and then select the signs. And it really does a lot of the work for you when you just select the different signs that you want to use. So that's a fun tool. If your child has a worksheet at home, you can practice completing that worksheet using KiwiWrite and see if it is a bit of an easier process. This is another great one, typing.com, 100% free, and it provides different games and activities that allow children to work on their typing speed. Working on typing speed can be made into a game at this point, and then children can just work on, competing against themselves to get a better score than they had the first time. It'll give your typing speed, and then it'll kind of collect data of how quickly you're improving with typing or different areas that you need to practice. It is very guided, and they have different games like driving the race car with typing or popping balloons or just really interactive fun that you can work on while you're practicing your finger placement and the speed. Seeing AI is another tool that is free, and it's primarily used for children who have visual impairments, but it essentially allows you to take a picture or a photo of any item in the environment, whether it's something out of the pantry, whether it's a book, a chair, anything that might be in the environment, even a face, and then it'll read whatever it's looking at. So if I take a picture of a cup, it'll then say cup, black cup on a table, or it'll say, man with beard and hair, and it'll just read whatever is being displayed in that picture. And that really helps children who struggle with reading small text or who have trouble identifying small things in the environment. And if you have a child who may benefit from this, just getting them to have fun with this tool in the house, getting them to take pictures of different things in the environment and practice, household items, games, toys in the house, and just see how, taking a picture of it, you can really hear what is going on in that environment where you might have a visual challenge.
Right.
Okay. Adaptive toys. So we have some children who have challenges with fine and gross motor, and there are many toys that we can use for these children just to keep them engaged and to keep them having fun in the home environment. I have linked several adaptive toys that are for all different ages, but adaptive toys really allow children to be able to participate in their home environment, still getting to do fun things. I've got some students who use PlayStations and Xboxes and Nerf guns and water guns and playing card games, all with adaptive toys. Many of them are switch powered, meaning they're operated by tapping a switch, and then that allows the game to start or to move or to be controlled. Okay. And it's important to remember that assistive technology is not one size fits all. There are many tools out there, and we really want to show our children that assistive technology isn't always daunting. It's not always going to be more work. When you're at home using these tools, it can be made fun. As I mentioned, using them to create creative writing pieces, to do diary entries, to do creative reading, fun reading for literature. Any of that would be great ways to incorporate assistive technology in the home environment. Assistive technology is growing and changing, and it's everywhere. It's here to stay. So it's really important that we get our kids involved with the technology and allow it to be as fun and a great experience for them. Okay. And I have some takeaways. Assistive technology, our goal is to always level the playing field and give our children access to different things that they can use in their environment and at home. All right. And so I wanted to open up the floor for questions. I know I went over a lot of information, and I just wanted to hear if you guys have any questions for me about any of the different tools or any of the decision-making process for assistive technology.
I think everybody's quiet this afternoon. Thank you so much for all the great information.
I see that someone's mic is not working, but they might have a question.
Nope, here we go. Oh, nobody says our mic isn't working.
Okay. You might be able to put your question in the chat if you're having a mic challenge, if that would be okay. When would you recommend for a student who has an emo okay, so what would you recommend for a student who has an emotional disability? That's a great question. And it really just depends on how that emotional disability is impacting their participation in the classroom. Mindfulness apps, absolutely. Mindfulness apps to just kind of work on emotion regulation, huge impact on students. There are many different tools that specifically work on just controlling and working on emotions and putting games that have children work on different scenarios that they could respond in different situations. I can put a couple of them at the end of my presentation so that you can then have access to them. But there are definitely a couple of different apps that could benefit. I'm also thinking there are different, it really just depends on what specific barrier the emotional disability is causing. Awesome. Okay. All right. Any other questions?
All right. Well, thank you all for spending after a little bit of your afternoon with us. If you have signed up, we will send the re link of the recording out to you, as well as a copy of Kiara's presentation that will have all the links and the information about the resources that she shared.
And I will also add some information on different mindfulness apps and different things that we can use with children who do have emotional disabilities.
So, thank you all so much for being with us this afternoon. Have a great evening.
Thank you. This was great. Thanks so much.